Sir, I thank the I'd like to thank the IMA Kodapakkam branch for the opportunity, and I thank everyone who has been here in attendance for this evening meeting. I'm here to briefly present on what I think is current day's manifold and metabolic syndrome. I'm not here going to teach you anything, but I'm going to tell you what is currently happening and what is the understanding of the manifold. And at the end of the session, I would welcome all you to throw any questions and we can have a discussion of what is the scenario. Defining manifold, it's a common condition that refers to a spectrum of liver diseases, ranging from steatosis to non-alcoholic steatohepatitis to cirrhosis or hepatocellular carcinoma. It's mainly characterized by presence of large quantity of fat in the liver with absence of significant alcohol ingestion or no ingestion of alcohol. You have to understand the dose of alcohol is 20 grams per day, and you know that a whiskey, which is about 30 mils, contains 8 grams of alcohol. So that is how you characterize, and you just want to exclude people who don't take significant quantities of alcohol. The spectrum of NAFLD or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is varied. It starts with a simple fatty liver where there is accumulation of fat in the liver, to an inflamed fat-filled liver, which is steatohepatitis, and the next is scarring of the liver, which is cirrhosis, and from there to hepatocellular carcinoma. Epidemiology, in the West, the prevalence of fatty liver is reported to be 10 to 24% in the general population and 57 to 74% in obese individuals. The corresponding rates for NASH are about 3 to 4% in the general population and 15 to 20% in obese individuals. Of these patients with NAFLD, about 15 to 25% of these NASH patients will develop, cirrhosis. That's a quarter of these patients whom you think are having NASH will end up in cirrhosis, out of which about 30 to 40%, it's about roughly one third of them, will end up having a serious liver injury, liver failure, liver cancer, or death in the next 10 years. NAFLD can occur at all age groups. Please do be aware that NAFLD can occur in childhood, with highest prevalence reported in the 4th and the 5th decade. What about in India? It's emerging as the important cause of liver disease in India. Epidemiological data says that about approximately up to 32% of the general population in India have a high prevalence of obesity and diabetes, and there is increase of NAFLD in these patients. Clinico-pathological studies again say NAFLD is the most important cause of unexplained rise of hepatic transaminases, cryptogenic cirrhosis, and cryptogenic HCC in Indian population. There is a high prevalence of insulin resistance, and nearly half of the Indian patients with NAFLD have evidence of a full-blown metabolic syndrome, which I will be discussing a bit later. Extrapolation of the available Indian data suggests that India may have over 25 million patients with NAFLD who may be at a high risk of significant liver disease. What are the NAFLD risk factors? I'll quickly go into the most important ones. In nutritional abnormalities, it's obesity and a prolonged total parenteral nutrition or some of the causes in nutritional abnormalities. In metabolic disorders, the main thing is diabetes mellitus and hypertriglyceridemia. Drugs, synthetic estrogens, corticosteroids, amiodarone, and the most important long-term use of methotrexate can cause NAFLD. Surgery, jejunal-ileal bypass, bowel bypass, bowel small bowel loss, or biliary tract intervention, particularly done for obesity, can all lead to NAFLD. The last is occupational exposure to environmental toxins such as hydrocarbons. What is metabolic syndrome or syndrome X? One, it consists of elevated blood pressure or hypertension, dyslipidemia, impaired glucose metabolism, and insulin resistance along with obesity. Approximately 90% of patients in NAFL have more than one feature of metabolic syndrome, and one third of them have a complete diagnosis. What is insulin resistance? Insulin resistance, let me be brief, insulin resistance is a key factor which results in actual NAFL. That is the basic pathophysiology or the mechanism by which it causes NAFL. What is insulin resistance? Insulin resistance is where there is enough amount of insulin. Unfortunately, the insulin is not converted into work. How much of insulin you have, there is no conversion of glucose. The glucose is not being utilized. The glucose is not converted into glycogen, and the glucose cannot be used in the peripheral tissue, which is what is called as an insulin resistance. Why does this insulin resistance happen? This can happen because of obesity, and the obesity usually is due to visceral obesity. It is not the overall obesity or excessive body weight, but it is due to visceral obesity. Visceral obesity results in a defective fat. The visceral obesity is a defective fat. It is not a normal fat. So it does not produce what is called as an adiponectin. Adiponectin is a hormone which is important for insulin resistance. It makes insulin more sensitive. But because of visceral adiposity, because of increase in visceral fat, there is a reduction in the production of adiponectin, which is important for insulin to function. And because of lack of adiponectin, one gets insulin resistance. When somebody gets an insulin resistance, the body starts looking at alternative forms of fuel. What happens is, because the glucose cannot be utilized, it has to look at fat for its fuel. So what the end result is that it starts taking up fat from the dietary fat or from the adipose tissue. Either of these two start getting broken down. When the fat starts getting broken down, you all know fat gets broken down into free fatty acids. There is a limitation. There is a lot of free fatty acid coming from the periphery, from your diet, because the glucose cannot be utilized because of insulin resistance. Now what happens is these all go to the liver, which is the metabolic organ. So a lot of free fatty acids flows into the liver. Once it starts flowing into the liver, can liver utilize all these free fatty acids? No. There is a limitation in the utilization of these free fatty acids. The free fatty acids have to be undergoing a beta oxidation through Krebs cycle, and you start getting energy through ATPs. Now that these free fatty acids, there is a rate limiting step. Because these free fatty acids, all of them cannot be utilized, so there is an excess accumulation of free fatty acid in the liver. Now, having got partially utilized, the rest of them gets packaged into triglycerides. When they get packaged into triglycerides, the amount of fat inside the hepatocytes starts swelling up. That is how you get a fatty liver. So this is insulin resistance in NAFLD in short. So I'll be briefly going into what is NAFLD and obesity, NAFLD and dyslipidemia, NAFLD and diabetes. What is the connection between NAFLD and obesity? NAFLD, more than 70% of the NASH patients are obese. NASH is, again, when you come to the spectrum of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, there is fatty liver, which is benign. Next is NASH, next is cirrhosis, and next is carcinoma. So the NASH is the inflammatory component of the NAFLD spectrum. From where I told you from the previous data, more amount of patients can go into cirrhosis and carcinoma. That's an inflammatory condition. And in more than 70% of the patients in NASH with NASH are obese. So there is an increased risk. If somebody is going to be extremely obese, there is a 70% chances that they can have NASH. Body weight ranging from 10 to 40% higher than ideal is associated with 4 to 6% higher incidence of NAFL. This NAFL can be a spectrum from fatty liver to the last. Steatohepatitis risk is higher in obese as compared to lean subjects. There is a direct correlation between the severity of obesity and severity of NAFL. Now, coming to NAFLD and diabetes, up to 75% of the patients with NASH have diabetes mellitus. Obese middle-aged female with diabetes are more likely to have fatty changes on ultrasound, up to 70%. The history of diabetes mellitus is associated with a 2.6-fold increase in the risk of NASH. NASH associated with insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia, even in lean subjects, are very well known, which is basically called as a lean NASH. Now coming to NAFLD and hyperlipidemia, 20 to 80% of patients with NASH have hyperlipidemia. They can have either high cholesterol levels and or high triglyceride levels. So basically, the NAFLD and the, is NAFLD a component of metabolic syndrome? No, NAFLD may be a end result or part of the metabolic syndrome. On one end, you have obesity, the other is type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, all together contribute to NAFLD. So, NAFLD may be a hepatic consequence of the metabolic syndrome. Which type of obesity is more harmful? It's a visceral obesity. Why is visceral obesity more harmful? Because it is associated with the following complications. What is visceral obesity? It's a truncal obesity where you've got a lot of fat on your abdominal wall, you've got a lot of fat in your viscera, particularly in the abdominal cavity, and visceral obesity is associated with serious complications such as diabetes, high blood pressure, cardiovascular disorders, and dyslipidemia. Why is visceral obesity dangerous? Visceral obesity is dangerous because the fat which is broken down from the visceral fat can directly enter the liver through the portal vein without making any changes, and it can directly enter into the liver. The elevated free fatty acid so that enter from the visceral fat can cause glucose intolerance and dyslipidemia, ultimately contributing to the hepatic steatosis and steatohepatitis. The other problem is that when you look at NAFLD or NASH, you first get what is called as a fatty liver, which is the first hit, and then once you have that, you know, you see that this is obesity, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, this triangle all contribute to hepatic component of metabolic syndrome, which is NAFLD. Once you have fatty accumulation of hepatocytes, then you have a second hit, which is called as the oxidative stress. You've got too much of fat inside the hepatocytes, they all get packed up, there is a defective packing, there is a stress on the endoplasmic reticulum, you get reactive oxygen species being liberated, you get a lot of inflammation, there is death of hepatocytes. That's what happens when you have an oxidative stress. When there is a death of hepatocytes, when there is an inflammation, you get NASH, or you get steatohepatitis or inflammation, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, which is what you get. Once you get NASH, this is a very severe inflammatory condition. This predisposes somebody to vascular inflammation throughout the body. When the vascular inflammation happens, it increases the cardiovascular risk. So NASH can increase the cardiovascular mortality indirectly by promoting vascular inflammation. NAFLD pathogenesis, as I said, the first is accumulation of fat in the liver, which is simple steatosis. Then what happens is that you have NASH, which is the next step. When there is a poor packing of the hepatocytes, fatty acids into triglycerides in the liver, that, and there is reactive oxygen radicals being produced, it contributes to NASH. This NASH, from there is damage and causes fibrosis. The fibrosis is there is regeneration and there is scarring. When the scarring exceeds the regeneration, you develop cirrhosis, and it is important to know NAFLD is an important cause of cryptogenic cirrhosis and hepatocellular carcinoma. So this is what I was trying to tell you. When you have insulin resistance, low adiponectin due to visceral adiposity, you get insulin resistance, and once you get insulin resistance, the adipose distribution gets broken down, you get free fatty acids. Excess dietary food produces free fatty acids. You got lots of free fatty acids, and there is decreased beta oxidation, because you can have only X amount of free fatty acids going into the Krebs cycle, the rest all gets packaged into triglycerides, and that leads to steatosis. One, it can be excreted as VLDL, or it continues to be inside the hepatocyte, which is the first hit on the fatty hepatocytes. The next hit would be the oxidative stress, which results in NASH. So the three hit hypothesis in NAFLD is that you get accumulation of free fatty acids, you get oxidative stress, which is the second hit, and the third stress is that prolonged oxidative stress, where the fibrosis exceeds the regeneration, you get cirrhosis, and finally from there you develop carcinoma. Role of oxidative stress, first is nothing much more so in steatosis. Oxidative stress starts playing when there is a second hit, but when it continues to hit the liver more and more without stopping, then that is when you get fibrosis and cirrhosis. Oxidative stress is the key role, plays a very, very important key role in digestion, in disease progression in NAFLD. NAFLD clinical presentation, majority of patients, many of us could have NAFLD and may be completely asymptomatic. Diagnosis, when do we establish a diagnosis of NAFLD? When there are abnormal findings on routine biochemistry, just go for a checkup, you find out your enzymes are elevated. Abdominal ultrasound performed for some reason says that you have a fatty liver. You start investigating for cardiovascular risk, that is when you may end up finding that you have NAFLD. Symptoms it present may include a slight fatigue or right hyperquadrant pain, and the most important reported clinical finding is hepatomegaly, or in some cases even that may not be present. Biochemistry, this is where you have to constantly ignore that that's alcoholic liver disease. The biochemistry in NAFLD is that you have raised enzymes like AST and ALT. The ratio of ALT into AST, ALT is more than AST, whereas this is less than 1 in alcoholic steatosis. Gamma glutamate transporters may be significantly elevated in alcoholic patients, not in NAFLD patients. The weight is often excessive and the triglyceride may be excessive. There is no history of alcohol intake in NAFLD patients. When you want to diagnose NASH, you want to diagnose NASH non-invasively, because the only way to diagnose NASH is only with a liver biopsy. You start using non-invasive markers. There are several non-invasive markers. There can be several indexes. One is called air index, where you have where you use the various parameters like hypertension, enzymes, insulin resistance like HOMA index, and the presence of two or three factors predict NASH. This is non-clinical way of predicting NASH. And similarly, there is another index called BART, which you can use to non-invasively predict presence of NASH. Diagnosis is mainly by imaging. You want to diagnose fatty liver, the best mode is only ultrasound. Don't think CT and MRI will add any more than what an ultrasound could predict for fatty liver. Ultrasound has got a sensitivity of 90% and specificity of 93% in diagnosis of fatty liver. CT and MRI have no advantage over ultrasound. None of these tests can differentiate between steatosis alone and histological NASH. So there is really no point, once you have diagnosed fatty liver by ultrasound, it is no point to go and do a CT or MRI. When do you say that the patient has ultrasound findings of NAFLD? There is an increased echogenicity of liver, which means the liver appears very bright. There is increased liver contrast compared to the kidney. Vascular blurring, mainly of the hepatic veins, and attenuation of echogenic level in deep seated areas will tell you that this patient has definitely got a fatty liver, likely to be any one of the spectrums. Unless otherwise the patient has got clear scarring, the patient can have a fatty liver or NASH. Liver biopsy, histology is the only proven method to distinguish NASH from simple steatosis. It's a gold standard, but you don't want to do liver biopsy because there is limitations. It is a potential clinical risk that you can cause trauma or morbidity to the patient. There is can be variation in interpretation, and there is lack of clear guidance for biopsy in NAFLD patients. What are the advantages of biopsy? One, it allows a clear diagnosis. Provides prognostic information as to say whether this is a simple steatosis or NASH, and it also says if somebody has got cirrhosis, you can choose them for surveillance for NCC. Whom do you want to biopsy? Which is more likely to have advanced liver disease like age more than 45 years, where the AST-ALT ratio is more than 1, or the type 2 diabetes, or where the BMI is more than 30 kgs per meter squared, and the patient has got persistent abnormalities and you have tried to remove all the risk factors, in spite of everything, the patient continues to have problems, then liver biopsy may be indicated, particularly to confirm and prognosticate. Histological features, I will not go into the details of histological features, but the spectrum includes one, just a simple macrovascular steatosis, then there is globular inflammation with Van-Rehalin, then comes the fibrosis and then the cirrhosis. This happens as time progresses, you find one moving up the spectrum from simple macrovascular steatosis to cirrhosis. Now, how do you approach a patient with NAFLD? One, if you have a suspected clinical or radiological NAFLD, liver enzymes. If it's completely normal and you still suspect NAFLD, just monitor the liver enzymes once in 6 months' time. If there's a persistent elevation, look at the risk factors. If there are risk factors like obesity, diabetes, or anything like that, try to correct the associated condition and see if the liver enzymes are elevated. If the liver enzymes remain elevated, then you will have to go for the liver biopsy. If the liver enzymes return back to normal, then monitor like here. Now, there are no risk factors, there is persistent elevation of liver enzymes, then the only way is to go for a liver biopsy. If there is NASH, you have to treat the NASH as it is. If there is no NASH, then you have to, you have to just monitor the liver function test. NAFLD objectives of treatment, there are very limited therapeutic intervention. The therapy mainly focuses on diet, weight loss, and there are some pharmacological treatments that are coming into the fore now, but maybe in the future you may have a lot more to treat with. How do you treat stage one when there is simple steatosis? When there is a first hit, you want to target the insulin resistance. The drugs that you use are thiazolidines like pioglitazone, or you can use metformin. The second stage where there is NASH or excessive damage to liver cells, you want to use antioxidants. And the last stage is that the third stage when there is fibrosis and cirrhosis, you want to use hepatoprotective agents and you want to give drugs which will promote regeneration of the liver cells. Treatment options are gradual weight loss, exercise program, treat the diabetes, treat the lipid disorder, use UDCA, vitamin E, other hepatoprotective agents. Sometimes phlebotomy may help, particularly if there is an iron overload. Calorie restriction, this has been found to be consistently useful in patients with NAFLD, and moderate weight loss, approximately 6%, improves insulin resistance and reduces the intrahepatic lipid content of the hepatocytes. Weight loss, weight loss, weight loss. This is the dictum and mantra for treating NAFLD patients. It's a mainstay non-pharmacological intervention. Gradual weight loss is important and not sudden weight loss. It gives a sustained improvement in liver enzymes, improves the serum insulin levels, and improves insulin resistance, improves quality of life, and any weight loss post-surgery associated with improvement in liver histology. Pharmacotherapy, insulin sensitizers, metformin, you can use, it acts on the mitochondria. The metformin should be used only in patients, only in patients who are diabetics, long-term use, not yet characterized. It is not to be used in routine clinical practice in non-diabetic patients with NASH. Thiazolidines, the only authorized drug is pioglitazone, which has been tried along with vitamin E, which is an antioxidant, in Piven's trial, and it has been used for a short time, has shown some histological improvement in patients with NASH. Antioxidants and cytoprotectives, mainly the drugs that can be used are vitamin E and vitamin C. Vitamin C can be used, the use of vitamin E in elderly patients, there are problems fraught with it associated with the prostate cancer, but it can be used for up to 6 months to 9 months on a stretch. Pentoxifilin, good drug, it targets the TNF alpha, but unfortunately it does help the patients with NAFLD, particularly in giving biochemical improvement, but GI side effects are quite common. Hepatoprotectors, the role of hepatoprotectors, you have plenty of hepatoprotectors, but the only common drug that's being used in NAFLD is UDCA, particularly it acts as an antioxidant and a hepatoprotective agent. UDCA clinical evidence is that a dose of 10 to 15 milligram per kg per day of UDCA for 6 to 12 months is associated with significant improvement in transaminases and degree of hepatic steatosis compared to baseline. It is also known to cause reduction in ALT levels, reduction in serum fibrosis markers, improves the glycemic control and insulin resistance. I will just skip these slides and go finally into the summary. NAFLD is responsible for significant liver disease in India. Steatosis is relatively benign, but NASH has a significant morbidity and mortality. Prevalence of NAFLD in Indian patients have definite risk factors like advanced age, central obesity, insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, along with other components of the metabolic syndrome. Some Indian studies also suggest NAFLD in lean patients, which is basically called as a lean NASH. Prolonged oxidative stress and improvement in cytokine damage are the key pathogenic mechanisms in disease progression within the NAFLD spectrum, and it is more important that we stop this for prevention of progression of NAFLD to cirrhosis. Sustained weight loss and lifestyle modification is the mainstay of therapy. Insulin sensitizers like antioxidants, cytoprotectants, and hepatoprotectants constitute the pharmacotherapy in the management of NAFLD. High dose UDCA can be useful. There are two things specifically I have not touched upon today. One is OBT cholic acid, which is a derivative of bile salt, which this has been proven in trials, particularly in patients with NASH, in a reasonable dosage for a reasonable time. It is currently useful in NASH patients, but there are significant problems like cholestasis and pruritus, which has been highlighted, but it has not come to full-fledged use as of now in NASH. The other drug that has been currently used is saroglitazar. This is a drug that people might use in dyslipidemic patients. This is like pioglitazone, this is a dual PPAR. This is a paroxysm proliferative receptor agonist. It is mainly acting both on alpha and gamma. It is very useful in patients who have NASH, who have diabetes, and who have hypertriglyceridemia. It is mainly for dyslipidemic patients. Whether they have diabetes or not, it's still found to be useful. The latest paper came up in January in rats, where there has been a significant histological improvement in the rats. And currently, the human trials are going on. It's not come back as a full-fledged use, but currently, saroglitazar is the only drug where if the patient is dyslipidemic NASH, then it has found a good place to use. The number of patients I have used on is very minimal, but following 3 months of use, I have found a significant drop in the enzyme levels, but I have not had any histologic comparisons, but the studies are not out yet. Thank you.
Essential fatty acid, role of essential fatty acid is an essential element.
The essential fatty acids are one that cannot be present and produced in the body, then you have to give it from external sources. That has got nothing to do with the free fatty acids, what we are talking about here. These are the end products of the adipose tissue. When they are broken down, they cause you get broken down into fatty acids. These are one that causes trouble. Essential fatty acids is one which cannot be manufactured in the body, and you have to essentially give it from outside for nutritional supplementation. This has got nothing to do with the free fatty acids that are talking about in NAFLD.
Sir,
those
of
the
vitamin
D, sir? You can give up 88. We use up to 800 milligrams, sir. We use vitamin E 400 milligrams twice a day, and I try to avoid it in very elderly people. Particularly, there is some instances where people talk about possibility of prostate cancer and other things, but it is a good drug to use, and you do find at the end of 6 months time that there is a decent drop in the enzyme levels. But do you find a histological improvement? There are no paired studies or paired liver biopsies yes, there is a significant, but you go by a surrogate marker like a liver enzyme, enzymes which show a significant drop at the end of 6 months.
How about the top of the cancerous active files, sir, for the fatty liver?
Again, ma'am?
And for the active file for the Cadilla, top of it for that Ports India. They are telling
they are all, you know, see, the one thing is that vitamin E, there are multiple retinols. You tend to use this whatever product you are talking about is a type of vitamin E. You know, the one that is originally available from Merck and this one. Comparatively, there are the vitamin E is different forms. You can still use it. As long as it's vitamin E, you can continue to use it. But some of the vitamin E, you don't have to give a full 800 milligrams. You can restrict it to 400 milligrams. That's the only thing. Again, I told you that UDCA, we haven't really got any medicines. As of now, dyslipidemic, NAFLD or NASH, I have got only one drug, which is saroglitazar, which has been approved for use. But that, apart from that, apart from weight loss, correction of obesity, losing everything else, you know, lifestyle changes, you haven't truly got any medicine for that. So best way is to control those lifestyle factors. And UDCA, you can do a whitewash, like, you know, if the enzymes are go up by giving medicines, you can actually bring down the enzymes. Do that. Truly, how long are you going to give UDCA? Unless otherwise, the basic factor is corrected.
Sir, role of metformin and statins?
Statin has got a role. Statin has got a role, particularly in dyslipidemics, particularly if there is a significant dyslipidemia. The statin, long-term use of statin is associated with reduced levels of enzymes, particularly in NAFLD. There are people, when the liver enzymes keeps going up, they start dropping because, oh, liver is getting inflamed. I don't want to use statins. In fact, you should use statin. If there is a significant dyslipidemia, if you continue to use statin, the enzymes level fall down. What is the other question you
asked?
Metformin, I told you, you know, they're sick. How many of you, I do not know, how many of you have given metformin long term to your diabetic patients? It has got no role in non-diabetic patients. But in diabetic patients, yes, it has got a role. Try and give it to your patients. If the patients are happy, you are happy. Most patients won't be happy. It causes significant gastritis. They have diarrhea. They have lots of problems with the metformin. It is not a drug easily taken by patients. And no patient is happy taking long term.
Okay, thank you very much for a wonderful lecture. Now I request Dr. Arunachalam, past president, to hand over the secretary to the session. We move on to the next topic. Next day.